about how to approach when you are dealing with such kind of patient who is deemed to have a cyanotic CSG. Now, there are different kind of approaches to deal this kind of patient. Somebody say you should see what is the age of the patient. Somebody see what are the symptoms of the patient. Somebody have some different unique, there are different ECG findings of these patients. What I find, which is very basic and which is very interesting, and if you go into the thinking of the logic about these presentations, it is very interesting kind. When you see age-wise presentation or when you see symptom-wise presentation. So today we are going to learn on an OPD basis presentation. If a patient comes to you in OPD or in emergency, which is a routine scenario, if you are doing your residency in pediatrics, which happens quite often, and you don't have any time to get the X-ray or ECG done. So how do you deal with this kind of patients? So we are going to learn that. So we are going to learn in case-wise manner. So first is a newborn, which comes at birth weight of 3.2 kilogram LSCS delivery. Normal cry is there. There is no significant antenatal history. Baby is doing fine. Saturations are normal. Taking feeds well. And there is great 3/6 ejection systolic murmur on auscultation on second day. I would like to like you to hear to the murmur. Is it audible? Are you able to hear the murmur? One more time. You can write in your chat box. Is it audible? Murmur? Anybody? Not audible. Okay, so we can move to the next slide. So how many of you can say this can be a cyanotic newborn? I will show you the slide again. How many of you are in favor that this patient is having cyanotic CSD? Because when I get call from my friends in ICU, they frequently are worried about this kind of patients, whether it can be a duct dependent lesion, whether it can be a complex cyanotic CSD. So anybody, this presentation would fit in a cyanotic CSD presentation? I'm not going to go forward because this is going to be very interactive kind of lecture. Please, you can write anything. I'm not going to come to Kerala. So we'll go ahead. So this is the presentation which would not fit into a cyanotic CSD presentation because as you see, the patient's saturation is normal. Patient is doing fine, patient is not having any distress, patient is not having any problem taking feeds well. So such newborn coming on first or second day with loud murmur, it's always going to be a minor CSD. This is the echo that we did of that patient and patient was having a small muscular VSD. So this is to wash your brain up that these are the presentations which would not fit into a cyanotic CSD presentation. Now the second case, a newborn baby. Normal delivery, birth weight is 2.8 kilogram. Normal parental events, baby is given to parents. And on second day, complaint. There is complaint of bluish discoloration of lips. This is the photo of that kid. We check the saturation. Saturation was 75%. So what do you feel? Does this presentation feel into a cyanotic CSD or this can be just a peripheral cyanotic patient? Anyone? Is this peripheral cyanosis or central cyanosis? Cyanotic CSD, somebody is writing, SAT hospital. Can it be a peripheral cyanosis? No. Okay, very good, unlikely. So we'll just brush up our differences between central and peripheral cyanosis. So saturation is the cutoff. If it is less than 85, you are dealing with central cyanosis most of the times. Skin should be warm before you check the saturation. There would not be any effect of oxygen and warming on central cyanosis. Decreased PO2, if you are having the facility of arterial blood gas, you can check the gas of those patients and you can check the PO2. Skin and mucous membrane, this is a very important point. When you are confused about peripheral and central cyanosis, try to look at the mucous membrane. In central cyanosis, mucous membrane of the oral mucosa, these are all always involved, and you can find a distinct discoloration of mucous membrane also. Clubbing and polycythemia, of course, they will come very late in the picture, but that is also a finding in differentiation of central and peripheral cyanosis. Now, this is a time-tested thing, hyperoxia test. I tell my friends and juniors to perform this test when you are having any doubts, when you are unable to judge whether the patient is having cyanosis because of respiratory cause, or cyanosis because of cardiac cause. And echocardiography, definitely, if it's not going to be available in a sooner time, this test you can perform anytime. So first you have to confirm whether the patient is having central cyanosis or not. After that, you check the PO2. If it is less than 50, then you bag the patient for 10 to 15 minutes with 100% oxygen. And then you check the PO2 again. So these are the three different PO2s you will get. If it is less than 100, excuse me. Hello. Can you mute your mic? If it is less than 100, then we are dealing with definitely a cyanotic CSD or PPHL. If it is more than 150, they have ruled out a cardiac cause and it is mostly respiratory condition. If it is 100 to 150, then we are dealing with something complete intracardiac mixing in case of TA-PVC or complex cyanotic CSD. This patient will be coming in gray zone, where you can't have any idea apart from echocardiography. So you can basically rule out two causes, whether it is respiratory or whether it is cardiac. So we did the X-ray of this patient, a second day old baby with saturation of 65% without any problem, without any distress. What does the X-ray look like to you? What is the shape of the heart? Please mute your mics if you are having this thing.
Right side.
Government Victoria Hospital, please mute your mic.
Any comments on the X-ray? Okay, egg and side appearance with increased pulmonary markings, excellent. Pulmonary markings, okay, I think it's not that much, because to label it as increased vascular markings, it should be more than two-thirds of the lung field should be covered. It is not looking more than two-thirds, but egg on end appearance is perfect. So we did the echocardiogram of that patient and you can see this is the right ventricle, this is the left ventricle. You can see the great artery coming from left ventricle is having branching, and right artery is giving rise to aorta, which is arching and which is having coronary artery origin. So patient was having transposition of great arteries. So one more in the category of these early newborns, day one, perinatal asphyxia. Patient had some issue in at the time of birth, and patient had to suffer from perinatal asphyxia. Now this patient has come to you in your NICU, and at the 5 hours of life you start getting saturation of 85%. You did the X-ray and this is the X-ray of that baby. Now, what does this X-ray look like to you? Anybody? PPHN straight away. Okay, but what is the X-ray picture? Chalo, one more. Day one, patient has having meconium aspiration syndrome and saturation is 88% on day three of life, day third hour of life. Now see this X-ray. What are the findings in this X-ray? So if you compare all these three patients, they have presented cardiomegaly with infiltrated lungs, excellent. So hyperinflation with bilateral patchy infiltrates, very good. So if you compare all these three patients, first patient had presented without any perinatal events, without any symptoms of distress or any respiratory difficulty, patient was having plain cyanosis. Now these two patients, they have also presented on day one of life, but they are having some parietal insults in the form of asphyxia or meconium aspiration syndrome, and they start presenting after some hours of life. So this is very important history. When you are getting this kind of newborns, try to elicit the parietal history, because there will be some presentation where this parietal history is not forwarded to you if a patient is coming to you after getting delivered at some other place. So in this kind of scenarios, as you told, PPHN would be a definite priority. It would definitely would be on top of the list. And in this kind of X-ray, where what you are looking in front of your screen right now, these are not PPHN kind of scenario. PPHN would be associated in this kind of patients, but definitely you are dealing with a lung, bad lungs, and your priority should be to optimization of the lung. So central cyanosis in a newborn in less than 1 week, these are the disease which will top your list. So there is definitely significant right to left shunting happening intracardiac. Transposition of greater arteries, of course, would top the list on day one or day two. Persistent PH of newborn, as we saw these last two cases. TAPVC, obstructed TAPVC, but that patient would not be there like TGA. TAPVC patient would be having some distress or respiratory difficulties. X-ray would be completely different. And complex CHDs, of course. This complex CHDs, there is a plethora of patients like unbalanced AV canals or DORVPS with hypoplastic left ventricle. These kind of patients can present at any period of life, but of course, day one or day two of life, they are very rarely to present, but we have seen complex CHDs getting presented on earlier period of life. But you can keep this thing in your mind when you are dealing with a central cyanosis in a newborn in less than 1 week of life. Try to elicit antenatal scans. What are the antenatal scans showing? And try to see what is the parietal events. If parietal events are there, then persistent PH of newborn would definitely top your list. And in PPHN X-ray, what we saw here, these are blackout lungs, because the pulmonary arteries are so much constricted, they are not able to get dilated. So there is vascularity which is getting hampered, and you see the blackout lungs. So anytime you see this kind of lungs with cardiomegaly, you are dealing with PPHN, of course, in the view of perinatal events. Sometimes there will be some patients who are not having any parietal events and they are having idiopathic PH and they present on day one or day two of life. But if this kind of X-ray is there, your priority should be to treat lungs rather than starting sildenafil in this kind of patients. So are we clear with the first case lot about central cyanosis in a newborn less than 1 week? These are the differential diagnosis. Now we'll go with third case, which is a 7-day-old newborn brought to hospital with complaints of fast breathing, bluish discoloration of lips are there noticed since last 2 days. Now it is a different kind of presentation when baby has been discharged from your hospital. Earlier 3-4 days have gone well, and after that baby has presented with sudden deterioration in the health in the form of fast breathing or bluish discoloration, and which has been noticed in last few days only. Earlier few days, according to parents, they were absolutely well, and after that the baby has deteriorated. Soft murmur is heard over infraclavicular area and saturation is 67%. So you saw the baby, you examined the baby, temperature is normal, but baby definitely is having some component of shock because perfusion is hampered. Baby is having tachycardia, baby is having tachypnea with distress. Pulmonary atresia with MAPKA. My God, if you can make out this diagnosis directly from the history, you are genius, I would say. So investigation, we did the X-ray, septic screen, and these are the results of the septic screen. Counts are normal, CRP is normal. So to summarize, this is the baby which is presented on 7 day of life, rather than our earlier patients who presented on day 1 or day 2 of life. This is a somewhat late presentation, a full term aseptic newborn baby which is relatively well doing till 5th or 6th day of life, and which deteriorates on the 5th day of life with respiratory distress and cyanosis. So these are the two things which should come to your mind, that something new has happened to the baby which was doing fine, or something which was there and has now changed. So what is your differential diagnosis now, rather than pulmonary atresia with MAPKA? So what kind of scenario we are presented here? In form of sudden deterioration in the health of the baby. Anybody? What is this class of presentation? Duct dependent, excellent. So what I wanted to make sure is, these are the presentations which happen suddenly out of the blue. Means your parents are clearly not having any idea why the patient has deteriorated. And first thing which comes to our mind is whether the patient is having sepsis, whether the patient is having aspiration pneumonia. But if you go in looking to the direction of this, because we many times misjudge this kind of patient, we put the patients on ventilator and we are not going in the direction of cardiac thing. So always keep in mind, if patient suddenly comes to you on 5th or 6th day of life, they can start coming at any point after day 2, because the physiological closure starts happening after day 2 and it keeps on happening till 2 weeks of the life. So from day 2 to 2 weeks, that is first week, ending of the first week to the second week, if you are getting any patient with sudden deterioration in the health in the form of either cyanosis and respiratory distress, or some patient who are having duct dependent systemic lesion, they would present with profound cardiac shock. Pulses would not be there, and you will feel that patient is having some dehydration, and the patient is not having any pulses. Hypovolemic shock is there. So always try to keep this thing in mind, that sudden deterioration, sudden presentation, you have to always look up duct dependent lesions. So we did the X-ray of that patient, and what is this? What is the shape of the X-ray? Boot on end. It's not boot on end, it is called boot shaped heart. Why the boot is formed? Now I would like to ask you, these kind of questions can come to you in your PG exams. Why the boot is formed? RVH, of course, and what more thing? Lifting the apex, okay? Absent pulmonary wave. That is the answer you should give. Absent pulmonary wave with RVH, that forms the boot, because this pulmonary conus will not be there, because if the patient is having pulmonary atresia or main pulmonary artery is so much hypoplastic, it will not be able to form the conus here. So you will be the pulmonary bay will be absent, and that will start forming the base of the boot. And of course, right ventricular hypertrophy will make the apex upwards. So Yeah, pulmonary oligemia is very profound. So I would like to show you the different pulmonary vascularities. So this is a normal vascularity where you can see the vasculature till half of the lung fields. These are definitely plethoric lung fields, where you can see the vascularity reaching till the extremes of the lung fields. And these are the oligemic lung fields, where less than one third of the lungs are lungs are filled. So we did the echocardiography of that patient, and what you are seeing here, subcostal view, you can see the aorta coming from the left ventricle. This is the aorta, and once the right ventricle comes, there is no great artery arising from the right ventricle. So the right ventricle is completely blind. You can see the right ventricle is not giving rise to any great artery. So patient, of course, you were right, SAT hospital. Patient was having pulmonary atresia, and patient was getting filled with the duct, and that duct got restricted on fifth day of life, and that caused the presentation of the baby. So pulmonary atresia intact septum, that was the present, that was the diagnosis of that patient. So central cyanosis in a newborn in 1 to 2 weeks with sudden presentation. So you are dealing with duct dependent lesions, critical pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary atresia with intact septum, severe TOF or TOF-like physiologies, Epstein's anomaly. Epstein's anomaly is very interesting disease which presents either earlier in the life, and the second presentation would be, so it has a bimodal age presentation. The second presentation, of course, appears in the second or third decade when patients develop significant dyspnea on exertion because of RV dysfunction. And because of that, the shunting again starts reversing from right to left. So these are the presentations which happen in Epstein's anomaly. TGA, of course, if the patient is having a restricted VSD or ASD starts getting restricted in day one or day in first or second week of life, then patient would present in a later period of life rather than on first or second day. So central cyanosis in a newborn, 1 to 2 week duct dependent lesions. Now it's a grown up baby, 3 month old baby, with complaint of fast breathing, difficulty in breathing and feeding since last 15 days. So this is a completely different kind of presentation where patient was good in first or second month of the life. This can be a second month old baby, this can be a 1.5 month old baby. What I want to draw your attention towards is, it is a grown up as compared to your neonate or first or second week old baby, but it is a little bit later presentation. So 3 month old baby with complaints of fast breathing and difficulty in breathing and feeding since last 15 days. Birth weight is 2.5 kilogram, present weight is 2.8 kilogram. On examination, respiratory rate was 80 per minute. There are subcostal retractions, nasal flaring and hepatosplenomegaly. Now, if you see this presentation, what is your first impression? What is the first presumptive diagnosis in this kind of patient? Acyanotic CHD with failure. So basically, we are dealing with a patient who is having congestive cardiac failure. You are absolutely right. Now, saturation is 86%. So whether it is a acyanotic CHD or cyanotic CHD now, I would show you the video of that baby. What you are seeing right now is the signs of distress in form of subcostal retractions. You can see some bluish discoloration of the lips also here. So as you all were of opinion that patient is having congestive cardiac failure, so I would like to show these slides, which will help in understanding of this kind of presentation. So what happens in VSD? That is, suppose this is the aorta, this is the pulmonary artery, this is left side of the heart, this is right side of the heart. So patient is having left to right shunt in the case of VSD. So what it causes? The high pressure blood from the left side of the system will go to the pulmonary artery, which is a low pressure system. So there is pulmonary hypervascularity in the form of 1:2 or 1:3 shunt is there, QP2 QS is there. So patient would be having increased pulmonary blood flow, and which will cause the symptoms of congestive cardiac failure. Because of increased pulmonary blood flow, the pulmonary venous return will increase, and that pulmonary venous return will go into left side of the system, and that will cause LALV dilatation, and patient will start falling, start having symptoms of congestive cardiac failure. Now, completely reverse scenario. This is the right side of the heart and this is the left side of the heart. What happens in TOF is right to left shunt. So your deoxygenated blood from the right side of the heart will go to the left side of the heart. So what will happen? There is dilution of your oxygenated blood with the deoxygenated blood because of the right to left shunt, and you will feel the symptoms of cyanosis. Now, if these two scenarios have been combined in a patient, that is called cyanotic CHD with increased pulmonary blood flow. So what happens in those kind of patient? There is definitely a right to left shunt happening in intracardiac level, which is causing cyanosis. But there is additional left to right shunt, which is causing increased pulmonary blood flow, and you start having the patients with the symptoms of cyanosis with symptoms of CHF. So this is very interesting group of the patient in cyanotic CHD, which present with increased pulmonary blood flow scenario. Patient would be having all the symptoms which you see in a patient of VSD, which you see in a patient of PDA because of the increased pulmonary blood flow, but cyanosis also will be a part of those presentations. So this is the X-ray of that baby. Any comments on the X-ray? TAPVC. What is the shape of this heart? Figure of eight, or what is the different name used for that? Snowman's heart. Excellent. So I would like to show you this video. It would run in it is okay. So are you able to see this video? So this is from Cincinnati Children's Hospital. It's a very good presentation, diagrammatic presentation of TAPVC. So what happens in TAPVC? This is all four pulmonary veins, instead of joining into the left atrium, they join into the right side of the heart, either above the heart, either inside the heart or below the heart. But they don't join the left atrium. So you can see here, all the four pulmonary veins are joining behind the heart. And there is one upward ventricular, upward vertical vein, which is going up and it is joining the SVC. So what is happening here? This is the left side of the system, which is carrying the blood to the right side of the system. So this is the left to right shunt happening here, and which is carrying all the oxygenated blood to the right side of the heart. And then once all the blood is inside the heart, what happens? There is a PA for any obligatory shunt, which will carry that mixed blood to the left side of the system. This is called obligatory shunt because the left side of the system is not receiving any blood. So there has to be one shunt which will carry the blood to the left side of the heart. So this is the right to left shunt happening, and which is causing cyanosis. We have this confusion in our mind. TAPVC means pulmonary veins joining in the right side of the, and that causes the cyanosis. But that causes the symptoms of increased pulmonary blood flow. The cyanosis is happening because of this right to left shunt happening at the atrial level. So this is left to right shunt, which is causing increased pulmonary blood flow symptoms. And after that, this is the right to left shunt happening at the atrial level, which is causing the symptoms of cyanosis. And you see here, there is the right to left shunt happening intracardiac level. So we did the echocardiogram, and you can see exactly what I showed in that diagram. All the pulmonary veins are joining here. They are going up. You can see the flow of the pulmonary veins going up. And in the second slide, they are joining the SVC. This is the superior vena cava, and they are joining the innominate vein, which ultimately opens the superior vena cava. So patient was having supracardiac TA-PVC, and this is the atrial shunt which is happening in that patient. You can see here, this is the interatrial septum, and you can see a blue flow which is carrying the mixed blood to the left side of the system. That is called obligatory shunt in the patient of TA-PVC. So central sinusitis in an infant in more than 2 weeks of the life, lesions with increased pulmonary blood flow would start presenting at this age of life. TA-PVC, truncus arteriosus, TGA with VSD or PDA, single ventricle type patients with large VSDs, common atrium, hypoplastic left heart syndrome, if it has survived till more than 2 weeks, it also would start presenting. But HLHS kind of patient would come in duct dependent lesions, and they would start presenting in earlier period of life. Sometimes trough-like condition, they also would start presenting if the sinusitis is becoming apparent. If the infundibular stenosis has progressed to that much level, then they also would start presenting in this period of life. Are we clear with this presentation of central sinusitis in a patient in age group of more than 2 weeks? Okay, this is the fifth case now of a 6-month-old baby, weight is 6 kg. Echo is advised on routine evaluation. According to parent, there are no symptoms. The saturation is 85%. So I would like you to listen to the murmur. If the murmur is appreciable to you, we'll try one more time. So this is the murmur of that patient. Is it audible to you? Not audible. Anybody? Is it audible? Not audible. Okay, so there has to be some technical glitch, because I am able to hear it very clearly. So what we are having is a loud murmur, which is a long murmur, and after that there is a softening of second heart sound. So if you are having a patient at 6 month of age group with a long systolic murmur and softening of second heart sound, what would be your differential diagnosis? In the view of cyanosis, which is 80, patient is having 85% of saturation, but patient is not having any distress. Top. Of course, the tetralogy of Fallot. Now, there is a prototype in cyanotic CHD, tetralogy of Fallot. And tetralogy of Fallot usually starts presenting after second or third month of life. Severe kind of tetralogy would present in earlier period of life, but this is the age of presentation after 2 or 3 months, because after that time, patient's infundibular stenosis has progressed to that much level, which is not allowing the blood to pass through the pulmonary arteries, and there is increase in right to left shunt, which happens after this age group. So we did the X-ray, and what you can see here. What is the shape of this X-ray? Boot shaped heart. But what can you make out the difference from the patient which we saw in earlier period of life in the duct dependent lesion, the pulmonary atresia patient? What you are able to see is there is soft pulmonary bay which is visible. Is everybody able to make it out? It is not a completely absent pulmonary bay, but you are able to see a soft pulmonary bay or small pulmonary knuckle which is there. So that is the part I wanted you to get your attention towards. Is in a normal TOF patients, you would not see completely absent pulmonary bay, because there is main pulmonary artery is formed. Main pulmonary artery is formed, but which is hypoplastic, and this is the thing which is correlating with your late presentation. If the patient is having main pulmonary artery, it means there is the pulmonary flow which was maintained in earlier period of life, and it is getting diminished in later period of life, which is causing the presentation of that patient. So this main pulmonary artery size, which will correlate with the age of presentation. If it is completely absent, patient is going to present earlier. If it is there, then patient's presentation would be delayed. You can see the pulmonary vascularity, which is also not that much diminished. You can see till half the lung fills, you are able to see the vascularity. So we did the echocardiogram, and what you are seeing here is large ventricular septal defect with, can anybody enumerate just for the fun part, all the four components of tetralogy of Fallot? Start writing one by one. RVH, okay. Overriding of aorta. Infundibular stenosis. And VSD, okay. So I would like to show you all the components here. So this is the large VSD. You can see here, this is the ventricular septum and this is the large VSD. What is overriding of aorta? Your septum is deviated anteriorly, so that's why your aorta is not in alignment with your ventricular septal defect. This is your aorta, this is your ventricular septal, this is your ventricular septum. Usually they are in alignment with each other, but because of the septum which is deviated anteriorly, your aorta gets overridden. So that is called overriding of aorta. So basically, in TOF, the anterior deviation of the septum, which is the first part to happen, that causes the VSD to be formed, and after that VSD to be formed and aorta to be overridden. So this is called overriding of aorta. Usually you will see a single line that will be alignment, that will be in alignment of your aorta and the ventricular septum, but here you can't draw a single line. If you draw a line from ventricular septum, if you draw a line from ventricular septum, it will intersect the aorta at 50%. You can see the aorta, 50% of aorta is coming. This is the left ventricle. This is the right ventricle. So you can assume your aorta is arising in between the ventricular septum. So 50% of aorta is coming from left ventricle, 50% of aorta is coming from right ventricle. So that is called overriding of aorta. Right ventricular hypertrophy, I will show in the next slide. You can see a distinctive right ventricular hypertrophy. Pulmonary stenosis I have not shown because it's not that much important. So this is a classical tetralogy of Fallot, which is presented at 6 months of life. So central sinusitis in an infant more than 6 months of life, mostly TOF variants, tetralogy of Fallot, DORV, VSD, PS, corrected transposition of great arteries with pulmonary stenosis, single ventricle with pulmonary stenosis, rarely increased pulmonary blood flow variants like TAPVC, which is having a large unrestrictive ASD, sometimes TGA with large VSD, they also present in later period of life. To complete the list, normal pulmonary blood flow patients, SVC, IVC connected to left atrium, pulmonary AV malformations, Epstein with ASD again can present at later period of life with normal pulmonary blood flow. As Madam had taught, TOF with absent pulmonary valve, this would also come in this period, this list with normal pulmonary blood flow, because of PS with PR patient would not be having any cyanosis, and sometimes they present in very late period of life. Eisenmenger syndrome, they would start presenting after 6 or 7 months of life, and they would be having classical presentation of symptomatic early childhood, which is followed by asymptomatic period with appearance of cyanosis. So So they also would start presenting after 6 to 8 months of life. So after seeing all these different patients in different age groups, starting from day one, first week, first to second week, then after the second week, like in first or second month or 3 month of life, then 6 month of life, and later in the age group around 1 year of patients. So what you assess in this patient, what are the symptoms that you look in this kind of patients? First thing, as I told you, you have to confirm whether the patient is having central cyanosis or not. Second thing, what you see is patient is having any, it is of course spells, stroke and spotting. This would appear in the later age group, in after 6 month or 8 month of child, sometimes in the later infancy. Polycythemia. Polycythemia also appears in the later period of life. But what is very important is symptoms of cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow, symptoms of cyanosis with congestive heart failure. This kind of patient always should draw your attention towards. And when I told about duct-dependent lesions, so sudden presentation, when the presentation is happening out of the blue, that first 2 or 3 days of life were good, first 5 days of life were good, and patient is presenting suddenly, then that kind of presentation always should give you a hint that patient is having duct-dependent lesion. And without waiting for echocardiogram, you can start prostaglandin in this kind of patients. As I told you, try to look for the mucous membrane. Every time when you are having any doubt, try to look at the fingers, because this clubbing part is many times missed. Patient is presenting to us for the confusion of murmur, for the presentation of murmur, and what you can make out is definite grade 2 or grade 3 clubbing is there, but patient, the pediatrician has not noticed the clubbing. So try to look at the fingers of those patients. Saturation, pulse oximeter is very important tool to have you on your OPD table. If you are having any doubt, just get a pulse oximeter, get a saturation noted in this patient, because patient comes to us for the murmur and the saturation is 85%. And when I tell the pediatrician that patient is having tetralogy of Fallot, they would not believe. They would say the patient was having acyanotic congenital heart disease. So pulse oximeter is very important tool to have with you. Of course, the syndromic phases. What is the syndrome? Anybody? DiGeorge? No. Downs, of course, is a typical Downs phase with open mouth, protruding tongue. What is this syndrome? Yeah, this is DiGeorge syndrome. What are the typical phenotypic features of DiGeorge syndrome? You can see the malar hypoplasia is there. You can see the socket shaped ear, which is very having deep concha. You can see fish-like mouth. You can see frontal bulging. So these are all typical features of DiGeorge syndrome. What CHDs are common in DiGeorge syndrome? How many DiGeorge syndrome would be having CHD? Conotruncal. What is conotruncal defect? So large VSD, DORV, tetralogy, all these things, tetralogy of pulmonary atresia, all these things come in the conotruncal septal. Conotruncal means the part where the conus and the trunk are meeting, in the conal septum and the trunk which are meeting, that part is defective. So patient could be having large VSD, patient can be having DORV, patient can be having TOF. These are the symptoms, and sometimes only arch problems, they are also very common in DiGeorge syndrome. 60% of DiGeorge syndrome would be having CHD. What is the shape of this x-ray? We are just revising here now. Good. What is the shape of this x-ray? box shaped at excellent. Which abnormality would be having box shaped at? Epstein's, very good. This is X-ray. Egg one side appearance, very good. This one. Snowman, very good. So final impression would be definitely echocardiography. So I would advise everybody to start doing echocardiography. If you are having echocardiography machine by your side in your hospital, try to just get a hint of what heart exactly looks like. If you are getting two or three views nicely, you can make out almost 70-80% of the diagnosis of those patients. So when looking for cyanosis, always try to examine the mucous membrane along with the skin. Do liberal use of pulse oximeter when you are in doubt. Do not forget to do hyperoxia test. Get chest x-rays done. And cyanosis is curable. Now, in treatment part, in tetralogy fellow, the patients with cyanotic CHD with decreased pulmonary blood flow, TOF-like situations, DORV, PS, TGA, VSD, PS, we routinely give two medications. One is beta blocker, that is we give in the form of Inderal, propranolol, and one is iron. Now, can anybody tell me what is the importance of both these medications, Inderal and iron? Okay, so we are starting the questions now. What is the significance of four-lane pulse oxygen? Now, the importance of getting four-lane pulse, iron. Okay, so we'll finish off with my question now. Iron is to prevent anemia, but how it would help in TOF patients to prevent anemia? And in tetralogy fellow, patient is going to have polycythemia, iron to prevent anemia because of polycythemia. So we are okay. So basically what happens in tetralogy of fellow patients, there is increased production of RBCs. And if you are not giving the iron supplement, the patient is going to have the RBC production, but the quality of those RBCs are not going to be good. Patient, the RBCs would be microcytic and hypochromic. So, spell can be prevented. That is the ultimate motive of the iron. Because of this microcytic hypochromic anemia, the patient's blood viscosity would be more, and that will cause stagnation of the blood in the central nervous system. So, patient can be having, rather than spell, patient can be having the brain infarct. So, the infarcts can be prevented because of iron therapy. And Inderal, what is the use of Inderal? Why we give Inderal in tetralogy of fellow patients? What is the use of Inderal? Decreases Indian infundibular spasm. So now this was excellent. Reduces rate. This is the answer which I was, excellent. This was the answer which I was hoping you will give. Because what happens in tetralogy of fellow patients, there is right to left shunt. The right to left shunt happens because of the balance between PVR and SVR, pulmonary vascular resistance and systemic vascular resistance. Lower the SVR, more will be the right to left shunt. And this SVR variability is because of the heart rate variability. More the variation in the heart rate, your SVR is going to be fluctuating. So what we want to do is you want to stabilize your SVR by stabilizing your heart rate, by decreasing your heart rate. So Inderal works on the SVR rather than infundibular spasm. This infundibular spasm is a confusion or it is a misnomer thing. So what you are trying to achieve with your Inderal is you trying to lower the heart rate. Less the heart rate, less the patient's SVR is going to be fluctuating, less the right to left shunt. There are less the chances that there will be sudden right to left shunt happening and patient will be going into spell. So basically, Inderal is to prevent the spells and iron is to prevent the brain complications in the patients of tetralogy fellow. Now, one question was there, what is the importance of forelimb saturation? Basically, forelimb saturation important is just to make out whether any, first thing, it is very important in cases of PPHN, persistent pulmonary hypertension of newborn. Because in PPHN patient, the shunting is happening mainly at the ductal level. The duct is shunting right to left. So what you do is you check the saturation in right arm, which is getting supplied with your innominate or brachiocephalic artery from the right subclavian artery. So that saturation is not going to be affected because of the ductal saturation, because of the ductal shunting. And then you check the saturation in either of the lower limb. If either of the lower limb saturation and the right upper limb saturation is having difference of more than 10, you can make out that there is a significant ductal shunting happening, and that ductal shunting is causing the right to left shunt, and that your decrease in the lower limb saturation. If it is more than 10 or more than 15, definitely right to left shunting is happening at the ductal level. If you check the saturation in left upper limb, there is a theory that if the ductal shunt is getting percolated into the left subclavian artery, your left upper limb saturation also will be lower. Sometimes happens that patient would be having juxtaductal coarctation, and that coarctation, that subclavian artery is arising exactly at the site of coarctation or below the coarctation level in cases of near interruption or arch interruption, where the subclavian artery is arising from the descending aorta, which is getting supplied by your PDA. So in those kind of patients, your left upper limb saturation would be giving you false ideas. So always try to check the saturation in right upper limb, which is going to be supplied by your innominate artery in cases of left aortic arch, and try to check the saturation in either of the lower limb. It's not important to you check to check the saturation in left lower limb. So right upper limb and either of the lower limb, that is my advice to check the saturation. It is not important to check the saturation in all four lower limbs, all four limbs. Any other questions? I think we would conclude the session here. In one more point I had to tell you, that cyanotic CHD with increased pulmonary blood flow scenarios, these patients you deal like the patients with acyanotic CHD. So these patients have to be put on decongestives rather than Inderal or any other drug. So you deal these patients, you give these patients Furoped, Envas, Enalapril. All these drugs will be helpful in patients with, because we are in confusion. The patient is having cyanosis, patient is having CHF symptoms, what to give. So always try to access those symptoms according to like acyanotic CHDs. If the patient is having hepatomegaly, patient is having tachycardia, tachypnea, definitely you are going to deal with those patients like acyanotic CHDs only, and you are going to give the drugs which you give in acyanotic CHDs. And one more thing, about duct-dependent lesions. In duct-dependent lesions, many a times pediatricians ask us whether we can wait for echocardiogram to start the prostaglandin, or we can start the prostaglandin. I would say you can definitely start the prostaglandin. If the prostaglandin is causing the saturation to go up, your diagnosis is made there and there only. That patient is having duct-dependent cyanotic CHD. If it is not going to harm your patient in any way. So anytime in doubt, patient is having sudden presentation, you can definitely start the prostaglandin without the echocardiogram, because it will help in getting your diagnosis also. After that, once the diagnosis is made, the treatment plan is definitely going to be according to the disease. But prostaglandin will help in stabilizing your patient earlier. So try to start the prostaglandin in those patients who are likely to have duct dependent even without the echocardiogram. Any other questions? So we would conclude the session here. I had told you earlier also, if you are having any doubt, you can mail me. You can this is my email ID. like to hear your reviews on email. If you are having any time, just.
Any doubts or clarifications?
When should we check four limb SpO2? I think four limb SpO2, I would say, as I had explained you earlier, four limb saturation is not having any importance. As I told you, the logic behind checking the upper limb and lower limb saturation is this only. If you are having any other confusion, then you can ask me directly. Otherwise, four limb saturation, I don't think it is very important. What which day of life? When should we check four limb SpO2? Which day of life? Well, in routine patients. On first day of life itself, if the patient is having a cyanotic CHD of that severity, where it is routine patients. In routine patients, what I would suggest is when the baby is born, you check the saturation. And I would again say that you check the saturation in right upper limb and any of the lower limb. And after that, at the time of discharge. So routinely, all your normal patients would be getting discharge on day 3 or day 4 of life. So at that time, if duct-dependent lesion is there, that would be start getting presented. So at the time of birth, at the time of discharge from your NICU, you should check the saturation. If the duct is going to get closed on 7th or 8th day of life, that patient is not under your control. You should not blame yourself for that. But I would advise that you check the saturation at the time of birth, because at the time of birth, we are in a lot of this thing, dilemma. So what we can do is once the patient is at the mother's side, try to get a saturation done at least at the mother's side on day 1 itself. And after that, at the time of discharge, you try to get the saturation of all the routine patients. Anything else? So, thanks to all of you for listening patiently and making it an interactive session. SpO2 screening recommendations. SpO2 screening recommendations. I don't think any the screening recommendations are there. I would like to search out in my distinct study papers. But according to me, these are the recent this thing what we follow and what we advise. I have to check whether it is any recommendations are there or not. But this is a routine thing that we advise, that you check at the birth or 6 hour of life and at the time of discharge from the NICU. Because if duct-dependent lesions are going to present, they are going to present, as I told you, from day 2 of life till second week of life. They can present at any time. So any recommendation, I would get back to you if I can get any recommendation for you. So thank you. Get back in touch next lectures. Bye.
Thank you, Dr. Divish, for your excellent presentation, and thank you all the institutions for your active participation.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. Thank you.
Okay.